Hi, I've been getting my kinkies and strokes as a sequencer inside of Ableton Live, so I thought I'd record a quick video that's going to show you some tips and techniques that I've developed over the years of using this. When you start using strokes alongside everything that Live has to offer, the possibilities open up massively. It can be difficult to know where to get started, especially if you're not used to this kind of workflow. So yeah, hopefully you'll pick up some tips in this video that you can use to build your own rig around strokes. So to get started, I'm going to load in the VST. And I'm going to just make a very, very simple sequence. So we've got this really simple sequence playing with three different voices. They're all coming out of this stereo left and right of the plugin at the minute. But what I can do is create an audio channel, and I can set the input to be any of the voices from strokes. So this is going to be the kick drum. That's the snare. And then here's the hi-hat. So back in the plugin, I can reduce the gain on all these. And you see that now the signal isn't going to the main outputs, it's only going to the individual outs. So once all the voices are playing on different audio channels, we can apply effects to them individually. And we can also record them, multi-track them. One thing you need to speed this process up is create a template. So I've got one here called Strokes Multibus, and if I drag this in, so it creates this group and we have the Strokes VST here, and then we have all of the individual audio channels that are all set up, ready to go. So that's the kind of audio side of strokes in a nutshell, but really the focus of this video is going to be on sequencing. So as well as generating audio on those voices, strokes is simultaneously generating MIDI data, and we can send this around our live project to different devices, plugins, or hardware. This isn't limited to just MIDI nodes, we can actually send control signals as well. To achieve this, strokes comes bundled with a max fly device that converts the internal plugin modulation signals to map buttons that you might be familiar with if you've used live LFOs. So let's load up the VST. And then we'll create another MIDI channel, and we'll load in the receiver. Now when we load up the receiver, it automatically sets up its own routing down here, so it's already patched into strokes. So we've got our plugin loaded on channel 1, and we've got the receiver loaded on channel 2. If I drag an operator onto here, and then punch in some notes, you'll see that this sequence is now sequencing the operator device down here. And so now that we've got the MIDI data coming out of strokes, we can start to apply all kinds of different MIDI processing. You know, you can get into micro-tuning, micro-timing, like velocity and pitch. We'll talk about how you can sequence the pitch later. First, I'm just going to build up a few different overlapping sequences, and we're just going to use strokes to sequence this one instance of operator. I'm going to turn off these logic channels down here. So we've just got these four sequences at the top running. So we've got this very simple sequence running, and next I'm going to start to modulate some of the parameters of operator using the modulation signals from strokes. So to do that, first we'll open up the mapping window of the receiver. That's over here. And you can see already that we've got these weights signals coming in. I'll just make this bigger. If I then start to add some values into the matrix sequencer, you'll see some of the sequences start to come alive in the receiver as well. So now the matrix sequencer is running, I've got all these different modulation signals that I can start to send to operator. So we've got this very simple sequence running, and we're using strokes internal modulation to affect all the parameters of the device while it's running. Next, let's add some effects. Yeah, I like the shifter before the reverb. Let's sequence the dry wet of this. And then the dry signal. All right, now we've got the voice and a few different effects interacting together. Let's make some variations in the sequencer and see what we get. So we've made a quick variation here, and you can hear how operator and all the different effects react into that sequence. We can jump back to what we had before just by hitting the pattern A button. And yeah, we can just keep creating different variations on this and different pattern slots. So yeah, I kind of like to use this approach when I'm doing like sound design stuff. I'll usually just hit record on the master output and, you know, just mess around for half an hour and see what different kind of sounds I can generate. Next, we're going to look at sequencing multiple instruments simultaneously. Okay, so we've got a fresh project again here. I've loaded in strokes and the receiver, and I've keyed in the little pattern up here just to get us started. So the MIDI is coming into the receiver here, and now if I drop a drum rack after this, without any kind of tweaking of any strokes parameters, it's already mapped to C1 to G1, which means that you can use each channel in strokes as an individual drum pad. At this point, we could start loading in drum samples and building a beat that way, but I'm going to show you some of a technique that I learned recently. So if we go back to our instruments and we load in an instrument rack, I can then create a new MIDI track, set it to receive from the drum rack, and then I can just get the MIDI from that one instrument. So let's call this lead. And then here I'm just going to like load in an operator just like before. If I set this to in, you'll hear that we've got the notes coming in. So we're going to start sequencing the pitch of this voice. To do that, I'm going to go to MIDI FX and I'll load in a scale first. And then before the scale, I'm going to throw a pitch device and we'll map that to matrix channel one. We'll tweak the range in the receiver. And then if we start to put some values into the matrix sequencer here, you'll see that we're now sequencing the pitch. Let's create another voice. And first I'm going to create an instrument rack inside that drum rack. And we'll sequence some chords with this. So on this MIDI track here, let's load in operator again. We'll copy the scale from before. And then instead of using the pitch device, this time I'm going to use the chord device. So we'll assign some chord changes here. And then if we set the MIDI to come from that chord here, so what's happening here is matrix channel 4 is sequencing the shift, and that's kind of building a chord on top of the note that we're already passing in. We could stack this with more notes if we wanted to. I'm just reducing the probability on that lead that we made at the start. Next, let's add a quick bass line. So this one's going to be the bass. So if I create a new MIDI track, again, we'll copy the scale from before, and we'll drop in another operator. Now I'm going to use channel 3 to sequence this. So let's punch in some steps. And then to get the notes in, we go to the drum rack and we pick our bass, hit the monitor in, and we'll pitch it down here. And now we'll sequence the pitch. I'm going to use, what channel is it on? Channel 4. No, channel 3. So we use channel 3 for the pitch here. Just got to tweak the range. So we've got all of our routing set up, we've got three different voices playing. Now let's see what happens when we start to mess with the sequencer. So let's take another look at what's happening here. So we've got strokes VST loaded on channel 1. On channel 2 we've got the receiver with the drum rack, and the drum rack has these three kind of like dummy instrument racks. We then use those instrument racks to get individual channels for each operator, and then we sequence the pitch, we can sequence chord changes, we can sequence the parameters of the synths themselves and their effects. Let's make another variation. Here I'm using the shares probability to get less note events. But yeah, this stage is kind of just about listening and tweaking and seeing what works. So we've got these kind of three distinct passages now. And you might notice that on the Strokes VST channel, we have these pattern and note buttons here. Now these are created by the receiver when you load it in. And what they allow you to do is change patterns using MIDI clips. Alternatively, you could line these up on the timeline and sequence changes throughout your track. So I'll show you that here. So if we switch to pattern A. Strokes has just switched to pattern A. You can go to pattern B. And yeah, this is going to be quantized because live's MIDI is quantized. This is our more spacious pattern. So with these three clips, I can drag them onto the timeline and just drop them around, you know, wherever I like. So I've added a couple more different drum voices that are just being fired by those four logic channels at the bottom. Channels are 5 to 8. But we haven't checked out the other sequences, so let's see what the other sequences sound like with this new arrangement. So we had no idea what we were going to get before we started changing these patterns. But yeah, you can kind of hear that, like, since all the parts of Strokes work together, it kind of always sounds slightly cohesive in some way. All the parts are reacting to one another. And yeah, once you've got a kind of setup like this with a few different things patched together, it all just becomes about exploring the possibilities of what the sequence could do. We can create another quick variation here. This make a good outro, I guess. So yeah, I hope this gives you a few ideas about how you can use Strokes and Ableton Live together. Yeah, if you'd like me to do more videos like this on different DAWs, Bitwig's a good one. VCVRX really good as well. So is Drambo. Yeah, I'll probably get around to those. But yeah, let me know if you've got any questions or anything below in the comments. And yeah, this is Strokes. It's available now as VST3 as an audio unit. New in the latest edition is like there's a Logic MIDI FX is back. I finally got that working. It's also available on iOS from the App Store. And yeah, you get this receiver device bundled in if you're using Ableton Live. So yeah, thanks for watching and hope you enjoy.